section. Moving from that nice overview from Carlos, I'm now going to be concentrating on combination prevention as it relates to Minuev 6 with men. The talk will be in two halves. The first half I am going to do a little bit of a quick evidence review because a lot of the evidence in this field has been in the last 12 months, and particularly those of you who weren't at CROI earlier this year may not have seen some of these data. I'm then going to look at trends in a few settings where combination prevention in Minuev 6 with men is being implemented to see how we're going, and spend a little bit of time at the end to talk about what we might need to see really substantial reductions. So, to start with the evidence. So treatment is prevention. Our final speaker, Mike Cohen, has just updated the world to HP1052, and we all missed it. But the initial result was, of course, this huge reduction in heterosexual couples. And in fact, only 2% of that cohort were men who have sex with men, and no transmission data were contributed. It'll be interesting to hear from Mike whether there are any data in the long-term study. And in fact, there are still no studies that have been published on treatment as prevention in men who have sex with men. There, however, have been two studies presented at conferences in the last 2 years, and the first and the largest of these is the European Partner Study, which enrolled serodiscordant gay couples in about 20 European countries. To get into this study, you have to be a serodiscordant gay couple who practice at least some condomless anal intercourse, and this is their key result in men who have sex with men. Overall, about 262 couple years of follow-up. No transmission seen at all, but you'll see these lines here are the confidence intervals, and you see overall the result is compatible with an incidence still of up to 1.5% per year with condomless anal intercourse and undetectable viral load. And in fact, for those couples who report receptive anal sex with ejaculation, that's the negative partner in the receptive position, the results are still statistically compatible with an incidence rate of up to 4% per year. So very promising data, but not conclusive. This year at CROI, I presented interim results from the Australian study of this question, Australian, Thai and Brazil study of this question, where we're enrolling serodiscordant gay couples. We found the same basic result of zero linked transmission in about a total of 150 couple years of follow-up, close to 90 when the viral load is less than is undetectable, and our upper limit of confidence interval is 4% per year. Clearly, eventually these data should be analysed together, and that will result in a tighter confidence interval. In terms of pre-exposure prophylaxis, of course, we've had the data around. It's amazing to think 5 years ago since the original publication of the IPREX study showing the 44% reduction in men who have sex with men. It's really striking that 5 years later we've got very little implementation of this technology. So that was the headline result, 44%. But in the amazingly meticulous biological data of efficacy based on blood levels, it seemed that those men who were adherent might have an efficacy of something over 90%. And the results of IPREX then led to IPREX LA, where men who were in the study were rolled over into an open label extension. And the extension very much confirmed the results of IPREX with about a 50% reduction and blood levels suggesting at least 4 pills per week being associated with close to 100% efficacy. At CROI this year, we saw really exciting results from two new studies, which are as yet unpublished. The PROUD study, based in the UK, which randomised HIV-negative men who have sex with men to Truvada versus waitlist. So it was a waitlist design controlled study, and not placebo-controlled, followed for 3 months. And the study was stopped after its pilot phase because of extreme levels of efficacy. You see here an overall incidence in the whole study population of 5%, but 9% per year in the deferred group versus 1.3% for an overall efficacy of 86%, an extremely small number needed to treat for a preventive intervention. So this seemed to suggest that the upper level of efficacy of the range of efficacies that we saw in the IPREX study could be achieved in the setting of a rich country like the UK. And at the same time, or in the same session at CROI, we saw the results of the first phase three study of intermittent PrEP, the IPAGAY study from France, which randomised men to receive Truvada before and after sexual intercourse versus men who received Truvada, placebo. So the event-driven arm were told to take two tablets of Truvada, 2 to 24 hours before sex, one tablet 24 hours later, and one tablet 2 days later. So four tablets over 3 days. And the finding was extremely similar to the finding in the PRAD study for an 86% relative reduction in the incidence of HIV, which began to emerge very quickly in the study. Again, with a low number needed to treat in this very high incidence population. I don't think many of us thought it was possible to enroll large populations of gay men in these Western cities with incidence rates of 6 or 9 per 100-person years. And it really says something about what we need to be doing in those populations. So in summary of the evidence, the treatment as prevention data is actually surprisingly sparse in gay men, but what we do know is very, very encouraging. So the two studies together have about 350 couple years of follow-up, and there has been zero transmission thus far. So this really is looking promising. Both the partner study and Opposites Attract will be concluded within the next 2 years, and when they're concluded, we'll have more than 1,500 couple years of follow-up in serodiscordant gay couples, and that will be should give us really quite accurate knowledge of prevention in gay, of treatment as prevention in gay men. In terms of PrEP, we now know that this is an extremely efficacious intervention if taken, and we think that more than 4 doses a week is probably accompanied by close to maximal protection, and that's great because it means it's a relatively forgiving intervention, and there is a lot of debate about whether the intermittent results of IPAGAY might simply reflect the fact that in that study men were taking 4 pills a week on average, and so it may not have been the intermittency, it may be simply because they were taking enough PrEP. So I want to change gears now and start thinking about how we're doing in settings where combination prevention is being implemented, and this is how we're doing it in New South Wales, Australia. This is based on a poster that ACON, our Gay Men's Health Organisation, uses in Australia, which puts together the combination prevention picture as test more, treat early, stay safe equals ending HIV. And I should say that, of course, this is, you see the bus has 2013. 2 years later, I think we need to add PrEP to this equation, and that's the case that I'll be making, really, for the remainder of the talk. I want to add a note of caution in what I'm about to say to you, because I'm going to talk mostly about trends in HIV diagnosis. No population-wide studies of combination prevention in MSM have used an incidence outcome. And that's in contrast to what we're doing in the African heterosexual studies of treatment as prevention or as combination prevention more broadly, such as SEARCH, POPART, ANRS 12249, and Botswana. So I think we really need to think about, in some of these settings, trying harder to collect incidence data. What I'm going to do in this review is to compare 3 settings, and I hasten to add that these 3 settings will not be representative of the world, but I've chosen them because they have good surveillance systems and substantial investment in combination prevention. So I'm choosing them because if combination prevention works in men who have sex with men, these settings should be beginning to show something. I should also say, not only is it not representative, it's not all the settings in the world that do this. So please don't feel offended if I haven't chosen your city. And perhaps at the end you can tell us about what's happening. I'm going to judge things against these 4 criteria. I'm going to judge it by how we're doing at early diagnosis, how we're doing with very high treatment rates, how we're going with widespread access to pre-exposure prophylaxis, and how we're going with increases in behaviour that pose the risk of HIV transmission. We have goals that UNAIDS has set for the first 2, of course, the 90-90. We don't yet have a goal for PrEP, and maybe we should. And in terms of behaviour that poses a risk of HIV transmission, this is getting more and more difficult for behavioural scientists to measure, because condomless anal intercourse is no longer always unprotected anal intercourse, because often it's protected by undetectable viral load and increasingly by PrEP. Nevertheless, that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to start with the UK, and this is going to be a very brief overview because I don't have much time, but I'll try to zip over it in a few minutes. So the UK, in terms of testing, started from a low base 10 years or so ago and has ramped up very quickly lately. And their estimate is that about 16% of HIV positives are unaware. So I've rated that as middlingly good. It's certainly a lot better than it used to be 5 years or so ago, but it's perhaps not as high we wanted it to be. The UK has one of the best services for treating people with HIV of anywhere in the world, and has 90% of, estimated to have about 90% of diagnosed people, that is, on treatment. It has a demonstration project, PROUD, and it has no other access to PrEP. And it has rapidly increasing rates of sexually transmitted infections, which may represent increases in behaviour. So put those things together, and what you see in the UK is increasing rates of HIV diagnosis. These are men who have sex with men who have been diagnosed in the UK, infected in the UK or infected while abroad. So whatever is happening in the UK does not yet appear to be enough to be leading to a decline. And one of the reasons in the UK might be that the increase in testing is leading to more diagnosis. And this is an occasion where diagnosis and incidence may be quite different. My setting in New South Wales, Australia, is a setting where gay men have been very frequently tested for a very long time. And about 75% of men test about yearly. 60% of diagnoses are either within the first 12 months of infection or with a CD4 count of greater than 500. We've done sero surveys in the gay community, which suggests that about 10% of HIV-positive men are unaware of their diagnosis, and we're still increasing testing rates. In terms of rate of treatment, the guidelines in Australia changed only 2 years ago to allow men with CD4 counts of more than 500 to go onto treatment, and that's led to rapid change. So we're getting about 90% treatment rates now. Interestingly, as we've treated better and better, one of the consequences, of course, is that our population of positive people expands and expands because we don't have people dying except when they get old. So we estimate over the last decade that the population of MSM with HIV has doubled in our state. And if you're trying to get prevention, that's twice as many people who could potentially be passing on HIV. So we think we're doing well with early diagnosis. We think we'd be meeting the UNAIDS goals. We think we're doing well with treatment. We certainly don't have good access to PrEP. We've got a demonstration project for 300 men, which filled in rapid time because everybody wants it at the moment. We don't have increasing rates of condomless anal intercourse according to our surveillance, but we do have increasing rates of STIs. So perhaps we are getting increasing risk behaviour. And put all of that together, we've managed to control HIV. It's stable, perhaps a slight downward trend, but really not much to it. We're not seeing dramatic declines with all of those things. The last centre I want to look at very briefly, San Francisco. So San Francisco is the global experiment, I suppose, in MSM prevention at the moment, with very high rates of early HIV diagnosis. Most of these data are from the San Francisco Department of Public Health report. Very high treatment rates, very recently, pretty good access to PrEP. Perhaps it could be even more, but better than anywhere else. But increasing risk behaviour, increasing rates of condomless anal intercourse recorded in behavioural research, and increasing STIs. Put that together, what do we see? And this is a slide I borrowed from Susan Bookbinder's recent presentation of data, I think less than a month ago, to 2014. Showing that we really are seeing declines in San Francisco, and since the introduction of PrEP, that's in the order of a 25% decline in new diagnoses. The one place, really, in the world we are seeing substantial declines. Even in that setting, there are warning marks, if you like. The decline is mostly in white MSM and not in other groups of MSM. So whenever there's a group who are socially marginalised, who are difficult to contact, who, for reasons of race, ethnicity, poverty or others, are difficult to get into the health system, we will have real difficulty in seeing large declines. So in conclusion, we're seeing combination preventions in many settings. This is a brief, unrepresentative snapshot. To my knowledge, and I'd be interested if anybody wants to challenge this, the only place where there's substantial decline is San Francisco, and that's mostly since the introduction of pre-exposure prophylaxis. I don't mean this to say that treatment as prevention is not a good thing in gay men. It's clearly necessary, and I think in many settings, as in my own, it's held rates constant when the population of people with HIV has doubled, when risk behaviour is probably increasing. It's prevented increases in HIV, but it has not seen to large decreases in HIV. And PrEP access is clearly the missing link in settings such as mine. And to finish with, I just wanted to acknowledge many people whose slides I've borrowed and many colleagues at the Kirby Institute who I fleshed these ideas out with. Thank you.